Hey, new trust economy. We are back. I'm Tracy Hazard.
And I'm Monika Profit.
And today we're going to talk about tokenization, which is such a hot topic. And there's also a lot of confusion about how it works. And Monika has such a great way of explaining how it works for everything that I just absolutely going to immediately throw to her to have her start it.
You mean my bicycle versus skateboard analogy?
Yes, exactly. So
if
you haven't read her book, she's got a book called Blockchain 101. And in the book, what I love about it is you're like, I had to figure out a way to explain to my cousins who think what I do is a scam, exactly what we're working on.
Yeah, basically. I was like, I was so tired of having this question. What is that stuff you're doing? Should we even ask? And I was like, no, really, like of all people that should ask, like the regular crowd needs to know. And then I was like stumped every time. It didn't work until I finally sat down and was like, analogies, just think analogies, glass mailboxes, you know, Instagram for PDFs, what else?
Right. And so that's actually, I mean, just want to kind of, if you're new to the show, just want to explain to you that that's what we are doing here. We're giving you analogies and stories. We're going to give you both. So interviewing people, and we're also telling some stories about things we've come across or heard. That way you have a vision of what does this look like in action?
Yeah, exactly. This isn't just like a deep technical podcast, because there are enough of those. And if you want to really dive into that stuff and hash graphs and all that, just go for it.
But oh my gosh. You
know, that is for really specific people. With like, I mean, that's for like me and my nerd friends do that stuff. But like, I understand most people. Well,
and I thought I was a nerd, but yet I still find terms that I'm like, okay, I have to Google that yet again. Because I still don't understand it. And Google didn't explain it well enough.
Exactly. Oh, speaking of Google, I do think that you actually Googled the phrase on my shirt.
Yes, exactly.
ITMFA. But there was they had a vague sort of not quite on the nose description.
So it was the mother figure already. So I don't
understand the mother figure already.
Yeah, I don't understand what mother figure has to do with anything. So,
Dan Savage, we love you. We appreciate you. And I am wearing one of your shirts.
That's
so
right.
ITMFA, impeach the motherfucker already.
But I'm still like, I love that Google called it the polite version. Like, I don't know.
How, in what universe is that man a mother figure? I'm sorry. In someone's terrible, terrible, terrible universe, that man is a mother figure to them. I don't know who, but maybe they're wearing a MAGA hat right now. I have no idea.
But what I love about it is that like, the idea that that's polite in any description.
You mother figure. Like,
in any language, like that just doesn't make sense to me. So anyway, Google, you think you need to work on another version.
Another version. Yeah. Or actually just go ahead and get comfortable with adult language. That's I think we can all be adults here. I mean, when children are on the internet at the age of 3, I think we've all heard the bad words by now.
Unfortunately, yes, from a mom of 3 girls. So yes, it happens way too early.
I bet.
Well, let's talk tokenization, because that's what we're here for.
So all right.
Let's start with your bicycle skateboard analogy.
Well, okay, that came up because right before this, you were telling me, well, I want to tokenize my business. And you were like, it's all totally compliant. It works. And I was like, yes, but also no, it depends.
Right.
And so, you know, it's kind of like if you were to just tokenize, that means like cut it into little pieces of equities and say, people can buy a piece of this. It's going to make money, hopefully. But you can't say it will make money. Don't say that. So, and then you just make it available to people. Well, that's something that accredited investors, people with significant amounts of extra money, who therefore, according to the government, can withstand that kind of risk. They are allowed to go do that. They're allowed to say, hey, Tracy, great podcast. Sure. Podcast is the future, whatever. Here's $100,000 because I have extra. And if I lose it, it's not a big deal.
Right.
Must be nice. But anyway, those folks have been able to do that for a long time. Venture capital, angel investment, all that stuff, it's available. You don't need a token model. You don't need any blockchain to do it. It's been happening for decades. But if you tokenized it, then they would have a digital record that's more specific than what would be drawn up by your lawyers with them anyway. And that's great. People could also then see that. It would be easier to reference maybe their tax burdens or the way that they're able to shelter their taxes. All those things would be more transparent.
Yeah. And I want to clarify that just a little bit. So there are cases in which, and we're going to be featuring them as we go up, but I have a couple of interviews that are coming up in the future where we're going to be talking about people who have set this up this way because they wanted to put metrics and funding stages within their contract or their equity buy-in. So they built in a smart contract essentially to do that. So that's yet another reason why they're going blockchain tokenization in the process of using already accredited investors, right? So
sure. I mean, and all of those things still can be done without the blockchain. It's just that it's like, you know, as I was saying before we got on this show, we started recording, and I'll say it now. It's kind of like adding bells and whistles to your bicycle. You're still able to get from point A to point B. Now you can, like, you know, you got streamers on your handlebars that are really pretty. But and not to say the blockchain is irrelevant. It's a better bicycle. It looks better. It works better. You can, you know, let people know that you're coming, use your bell, whatever. But you still can get over the line and get your deals done. And people have been getting funding for their businesses for a long time from accredited investors that way. The really interesting part about tokenizing, and this is where tokenizing something that has to do with a really risky investment like a business rather than an unrisky investment like a piece of property, historically at least.
Yeah, it's like, let's clarify, in certain times, yeah.
Well, but that also was built by like really, really bad lending practices. So that wasn't like
a business problem.
Value. It was a business problem that had to do more with banks and lending than with actual inflation of value inherently. But anyway, I'll get to that later. I'm off one soapbox onto another. So, but if you're to open this up to like unaccredited investors, average people, you and me, our friends, our family, my cousins, the people that need to read that book, all those folks that are actually going to benefit from tokenization, that digital asset, that the use of blockchain in that deal is a lot more useful to you because you don't need to then go get a lawyer to chase down what happened to those contracts. You don't need to go invest further capital in tracking and tracing what happened. Things are very transparent, and therefore it's like democratizing legal and contractual evidence and action, right? So when you have it in a smart contract, that was already set up once by someone, by a legal entity. They figured it out. They put it all into a smart contract. And when you signed it, it becomes automated. So enforcement becomes automated. Milestones can be automated. Those are things that matter a lot to people that don't have $100,000 to lose, no big deal. Or, you know, 20 grand to throw at their lawyer just to figure out what's going on with this thing. When the increments are smaller and people are trying to build wealth using a smaller amount to begin with, that automation is very, very powerful, which is why I call it more like a skateboard than a bicycle. This isn't like just the bicycle that gets, like, you know, accredited investors from point A to point B, blockchain or not. You know, if you're talking about a blockchain tokenized solution, it's a completely different way of getting there because it's for the average individual investor and it automates those things. Now, some of those investment opportunities aren't necessarily available to unaccredited investors on the large scale just yet, but that's because technology has preceded regulation in some sense with blockchain. There are more opportunities for people to use the internet to get their money to work for them. That's a new thing. The first wave of the internet was about basically talking to the whole world. What's going on in Nigeria? I didn't know. How can we democratize the news? How can we get more voices in what's happening of actual, like, reality, real time? Email started us there. Social got us there. That's all happened. The first wave of the internet is communication. This second wave of the internet is about money and value. And soon it'll be, how do I pay that person in Nigeria? How do I capture the money off of the return in that, you know, banana farm in Haiti? I don't know, whatever it is. Not that everything's going to be, hopefully not post-colonial, you know, colonialism all over again. But when we see more people able to be a part of more and more and more deals, regulation is now going, oh my gosh, we've never even thought of this because there's never been a vehicle for it. So for this period of time, you know, because there's a lot of laws around how people can invest and what they can invest in based on their income, because that's how much risk they can take, those laws are being readjusted and reconsidered because technology is now enabling people to do things, whether it's legal or not. They can block their IP addresses. They can do all kinds of things to get themselves into deals that, you know, we want to see the law in many countries, in every country, address this and adjust to this to see that more people in deals is a good thing within reason. And with, you know, with the spirit of the law being don't just open up these markets so someone with a really bad idea can swindle a lot of money out of a lot of people that aren't very savvy. You know, right. So if we can keep with that business and that spirit, I think that we're going to get a lot further in tokenization.
Yeah. Well, so let's talk about some ways that tokenization really works today. So when you're talking about, like, within a business, so within the consumer base that you have or the shoppers that you have or within an entity or a structure or a venture, if we want to call it that. Now, that's really doable and fairly easy to do.
Well, and it's already happening without the blockchain. I mean, let's talk about what about your cashback rewards on your credit card?
Right?
That is actual money. It's in fiat, which is, you know, like government-backed money, but it's not in crypto, but it doesn't matter. It's a money. It's something that you can use.
It's points US to dollars, money.
Points to money. So the points are basically, that's what a token could be, right? That's where a blockchain could come in and make that tokenized in a way that people could track more openly. Now, some people might say, why do you need that? Again, it could be considered bells and whistles on a bicycle that works just fine. But when you're talking about new technology, you want to start with where it's already kind of already happened, and then the new tweaks. So everything starts out as kind of a new bell and whistle. You know, somebody who walked into a medical office with a computer that could automate something, they were asked, are you a medical company or a computer company? Now, medical computing and medicine go to hand in hand. Nobody would ever force that distinction. So blockchain and cashback rewards and, you know, the internet of money, those are going to go hand in hand eventually. Right now, we see how we don't need it in everything, but as slowly it continues, it will be needed in everything. Somebody could have once upon a time said the AP, the Associated Press, didn't need Twitter. Now, you know, when that plane went down in the Hudson River about 8 years ago, and because that man was the pilot was like a veteran who like knew how to land this plane and just saved everybody's life, and it was incredible. The first picture that hit the internet about it was from Twitter. Was from somebody on a ferry going from Staten Island to Brooklyn, I think, or to Manhattan, and they saw it and they took a picture and they posted it. That was before the AP could get there.
Right.
So once upon a time, people said you didn't need all this social stuff. What's that about? And now it's eclipsing. So I think we're going to see that with blockchain more and more too. We can see an example, cashback rewards on your credit card, turn that into money, use it somewhere else, do it what you like, give it to your friend, buy an airline ticket with it. We're going to see blockchain playing a bigger role in those things. And that model becoming now obvious to people that, like, you have a podcast. Like, maybe you don't have a credit card amount that you can give people 2% back, but you could probably give them something else that would get them.
Can you tokenize your podcast and give listeners rewards of some kind? Yeah, absolutely. But can you do that with or without the blockchain? Yeah, you can. So
you can.
There's some of those things that are of interest to people. And yes, will blockchain make it simpler? Yeah, because then you could dole out rewards in any currency, exactly, as you pointed out, right? So because we have worldwide audience, right? Almost all of our podcasts, most people don't realize that, but almost all the podcasts have listenership all over. When I started my first podcast on 3D printing, I was shocked to find out how many listeners I had in South Africa and Brazil. Like, it was a gigantic community in both places. And I was like, what's going on here? And like, why? And so we started to communicate with some of our listeners to find out that they were like, there is nothing here for us. There's no training. There's no learning. There's nothing. But we can get our podcast. And so, and of course, we have to listen in English, but no problem, right? And so that's, you know, when that was an aha to me about how international communication had become.
And soon it will be international finance.
Right.
I mean, soon it's going to be, I didn't know I could invest in this. I not only love it and I see that it's growing and the listenership has gotten bigger. Send me your investment packet. I'd love to invest $5 in it. Or I want to get my cashback rewards for being a listener. I mean, that's all going to be, we are just a hair's breadth away from that being a reality.
Yeah.
So for you, you've got a great use case for people that are already internal to your system. Now, if you took that as a public offering, you would have to go through a lot of securities offering channels. It could be difficult to garner unaccredited investors. Why even go for accredited anyway with tokenizing a podcast? That's really just seeking venture capital money.
Well, and the way that I looked at it, Monika, was just an interesting idea, because I'd been covering for quite some time in my column crowdfunding. So like equity crowdfunding, mind you, I do cover Kickstarter and stuff too, but equity crowdfunding I'm talking about, right? And so all the shifts in the rules to being equity crowdfunding. And here's the thing is, like, I haven't found anyone that I could write about that really had a very quick and successful equity crowdfunding round. Like, it takes forever and it's really hard, and trying to find enough people with the amount of money they can invest because they're unaccredited means that you spend your entire year on the road trying to pitch people who may or may not be interested. And so,
or able,
right? Exactly. And so that's where I looked at that and I go, why would I do that just to reach $1 million, right? Why would I do that? But I've got 150 shows on my platform right now, and I will have likely 1,000 at the end of this year. If I raise small funds small amounts of money from people who are already passionate about our business, it's an easier sell. Now it's just a question of, do you have the funds and are you interested in being a part of our venture? Like being a more intimate part of it. Like that's an easier talk, right?
Yep,
that's an easier sell.
Talk.
And so when I looked at it, I was like, this tokenization really replaces crowdfunding with a much better vehicle for intimacy and growth for a business, as well as for the making smarter investment decisions. Because if you're already a part of an organization or you're already a part of this, you want to see them grow. Right. And why wouldn't you want to have a little piece and be a part of it? Right.
Well, and that, I mean, there's a perfect intersection of those two with Indiegogo. They've just started doing tokenized offerings. At least they did one. They did one blockchain based offering, and it was a real estate offering, and it was fantastic. So taking, you know, basically the Kickstarter Indiegogo model and adding blockchain to it. Now that's a no-brainer. They've already got a great platform, easy access. They've got a lot of buyers or investors.
Right.
They already have their messaging, their marketing's done. Great. That's a perfect place to start plugging in some blockchain. And that's why there's an early mover in that space.
Right. And, you know, and originally, because I interviewed the CEO of Indiegogo, he was a fascinating guy. And what he was talking about was that Indiegogo, of course, was originally designed to do crowdfunding. So their platform's actually designed from the beginning to do it. But when the rules didn't go through fast enough and the regulations didn't happen and there was no clarity in it, they couldn't do what they needed to do. So they quickly shifted to doing crowdsourcing kind of model, which is what I really call it, because that's what you're doing. You're sort of helping people pay for your sourcing and paying for your future product. And so doing that reward model was what their platform was already able to shift to it very easily without them, you know, losing all the ground and everything. And just saying, I give up and we don't have a platform anymore.
Exactly.
And so now it's coming full circle and they're getting to go back to doing that. So I actually think it's great because they already had the framework built in and they already had deep understanding there. So I think there will be more.
Absolutely. There will be more.
And I also think that they have a close partnership. If you guys, my article will be linked here. So you guys can go to the blog post for this episode and you'll be able to link directly to that article of where I interviewed him. And he talks about China and that they have a very close relationship. And with China's they're going deep into the blockchain and into all kinds of cryptocurrency and other things that is going on in China that we don't even realize and don't even understand, but they are partnering up with Chinese companies to help bring American awareness to the products and brands that are really good over there. There are some really great brands emerging and great technology products. And we're not seeing them here in the US because we're like, their names, usually it's the name. You're like, that name, no, that can't be any good. And it's because there's a mismatch there. And so they're helping to bring them consumers who can now talk back with them about what's working with your product, what's not working with your brand, how you can make this fit the American audience where they didn't have any buyers yet. So now they have consumers and now they have a conversation that can happen and improve their brand and move it forward.
And it's funny, you are from such a consumer goods background, you know, a production, a manufacturing, you know, so much about that space that your analogies there are just like so intuitive. And mine is more in the securitization of real estate, securitization of assets, larger assets.
Which I know nothing about.
It's great. I'm like, tell me all about this, you know, consumer products. What is going on? And then of course I can give you the same with real estate, but we are actually doing some deals with folks that are through Regulation S, which is a way to bring foreign investment into the US. We're able to help Chinese investors invest in American properties, companies, equities of whatever sort. So again, the regulations have always been there. The bicycle vehicle's there.
Right.
It's just not had the gas in the tank from technology.
Right.
And so now we've got that. And the trust, again, the new trust economy.
Right.
The trust can be there because people can really track it now. It's not like they gave them my money. They're halfway across the world. They don't answer the phone anymore. What happened?
Right.
You know what I mean?
You know what? That's one more thing that I want to define here at the end. And I love how you define things. So, I mean, I think that people get very confused and they think that ICO and tokenization is exactly the same thing.
Oh God. Yeah.
I know it happens. So let's have you define that a little bit right now, because I think that there's so much misunderstanding on that side of things.
Sure.
So now we get this idea that tokenizing is as bad as doing some of these scammy ICOs, and how did that, where's the trust in that? Right.
And so, Okay. So ICO, you know, stands for initial coin offering, right? So it's just like it came out of IPO, initial public offering, which happens whenever a company goes public. So with a company going public, they have all kinds of filing stuff. They end up on you know, the NASDAQ or whatever, they end up filing publicly and they're publicly tradable. And now it's no longer just for their early investors and the people that thought up the company. I think Lyft is going to go IPO. I think I read that on Crunchbase sometime last few weeks ago. But so, you know, for as an example, if you use something, Facebook had an IPO in 2000 and what, you know, 10, 12?
12, I think. Yeah.
12. Yeah. And so, yeah, those IPOs are a thing that people, that big companies do after they're pretty established and through very, very regimented means in the current financial system. Now, ICO, initial coin offering, was like these exchanges for cryptocurrencies, things that people just made up and said, here's so much of a piece of a thing that I'm doing. It's a banana coin. It's a coin for my dating app. It's a coin that you can use on my platform, but also I'm going to list it on all these exchanges. So when you pay 10 cents for it and I market it really well, or we have hit a couple milestones, or maybe we don't hit milestones because you don't really know what we're doing. These really scammy ICOs, these scammy companies that use ICO, they could make a coin, release it for 10 cents, people buy it, and then they go and exchange it somewhere on a third-party exchange for 20 cents and they make money. But the money wasn't made really strictly based on the value that was made in the company. It was too abstracted. It was too obscured, right?
Right.
So it became this like wild frenzy that was really based on marketing more than anything. So
it was based on demand and making money off money and not... Right.
And not making value in a company necessarily. Right. So making money off money and demand, that just shows us. It's like if when you finally saw people jumping onto email and, you know, saying, why use a fax machine? Yes, demand was there. The demand was absolutely drove the market in terms of communication. And I keep making that analogy because now I see the demand for investment opportunities is still there. It's just that, you know, we need to have better metrics. And this is where regulation has a real good place in this ecosystem. To say, okay, here are the protections. Here's the truth you have to tell.
Right.
Here are the metrics to look for. Here's why that piece of that thing is going to be worth something or not. And you can evaluate it by more than just the mono like messaging that comes only from the company who has an interest in you believing them. Right. We need third party assessments, and that's where tokenization of things that are third party assessed, whether they're, you know, if you were to say, for example, you want to tokenize your business and you just say it's worth $5 million. Well, Tracy, I'd really want to see some metrics around that. And I would appreciate it if you would get a third party assessment and of what your company is really worth. Right. And then I'm going to go off of that, because if you say it's worth 5 million, they say it's worth 2.5. I think your tokens might be worth half as much as you say.
Right.
And I don't have to be super savvy to do that. I just have to have access to that information to be able to make a sound investment choice. That wasn't necessarily there. It wasn't a standard for a long time. And people did make money as things were going up. The demand flooded in. And then it crashed because there were so many people that didn't have things to back it up. And they were just running in.
Right. There wasn't the value there.
Yeah. There wasn't value truly there.
So we have a disclaimer at the beginning of every single one of our episodes. If you're not listening to it, Monika and I are not allowed to give you investment advice. You are on your own. You all need
I'm not an investment advisor, nor do I play one on TV or on a podcast.
Exactly. You guys are on your own with all of that. What we want to do is try to bring you ideas, companies that are out there doing interesting things, but we're bringing them as examples. We're not bringing them as, oh, please invest in this company. We are not endorsing anyone.
Definitely not.
Including our own companies on.
Exactly.
Right?
Definitely not.
We're talking about it as so that we can help think this through as a community and really start evaluating what the new trust economy is going to look like for businesses, for investments, for all of those things.
And not only just the investments, but like, what are we making value out of? I mean, there's such a social impact aspect to this that we're bringing, you know, an entire crowd of people that were just blocked out of investing opportunities before. I mean, there is such a huge value in having passive income. Many, many people, most of the people on the planet do not have anything resembling passive income.
Right.
There's this very small number of people in this world that have passive income and they get all the deals that perpetuate further passive income. That is changing and that's exciting. And we need to make sure that as much information can get out there so people can start evaluating what that passive income opportunity looks like for them.
Right. What makes the most sense for you? So we're going to wrap this up today. This has been Tracy and Monika on the New Trust Economy, but please join us again. Please go to newtrusteconomy.com for the blog post and all the links in this episode, as well as find us on social media at New Trust Economy. We look forward to connecting with you.
Thanks, you guys.